This summer, I went back to the town that I was born and raised in, the town of Paris, Maine. Anyone know it? You know it?
Yeah.
Unbelievable. All right, we'll have to talk later, because I swear it was like you, me, and two pine trees. That's it. I hadn't been there for about 18 years. More specifically, I hadn't been there since I was a girl. The occasion of my return was a visit to the local bookstore, which was a site of worship in my childhood, to give a reading from my debut novel. I was more than a little nervous about contacting people I had known and asking them if they would come to the reading, but ultimately I decided it would be much worse to have no one there at all, which has happened more than once. So I emailed and wrote letters and made contact with a whole variety of folks, some of my old friends, my pediatrician, people I used to babysit for, and quite a number of former teachers of mine. The talk went well. I spoke about Deborah Sampson and also about my own journey as a transgender person. But the best part came perhaps a week later when I received a letter in the mail from Mrs. Burns, who had been my first grade teacher. She had given me the only minuses I ever received on my report card, one for penmanship, which was entirely well-deserved, and one for spelling because she couldn't read what I had written, which I felt wasn't entirely fair, not that I hold a grudge. Okay, I do. Her note, which was in very good handwriting, said, "It was a pure joy to listen to you talk about your experience as an author. However, it was your life story that moved me deeply. That you are true to yourself is everything." I think she's right. To be true to yourself is everything. But the question is this: how do you know who you are? Or not exactly that, because I believe that each of us knows. The tricky part of that sentence is that little verb, are. How does one be? How does one come to be? When I try to answer that question, I immediately think of my hometown. Maine was a great place to grow up. I was the quintessential feral child. My family lived on an old apple orchard that bordered on an abandoned mica mine, and my friends and I spent afternoons and weekends chucking rotten apples at each other, that would be the autumn, jumping into water-filled quarries in the summer, and getting into trouble in all seasons. I was pretty much a normal little girl. If you'd known me, you would have called, oh, there I am at four, it's a lovely dress that my mother made for me. If you'd known me, you would have called me a tomboy. I'd been named after my mother's favorite great aunt, Alice, who made her cats wear ribbons on Sundays and roll over before she would give them their dinner. She was a tough old bird, that's what I'm saying. I think early childhood is one of the few places where gender can be ignored, where it really doesn't have to matter. I can recall very early on wanting to be a boy, even I would say thinking I was a boy, or believing that I could become a boy. This feeling was especially acute on occasions when I had to dress up, and my brother would suffer to have his tie clipped on, and my mother would chase me around the house with a dress and tights and horrible shiny shoes. That's part of how I came to be, learning what felt comfortable, jeans and a flannel shirt, and what felt uncomfortable, tights and a dress. I couldn't have told you why exactly one felt right and why the other felt wrong, but I knew. Experiencing discomfort and trying to figure out how to fix that, that's part of coming to be. But it isn't just about clothes. I could have worn jeans and flannel shirts for the rest of my life, and that wouldn't have made me myself. I think the key to becoming is language. Being given the words, being taught to articulate, being asked and having to answer, and then being asked again and again. If we can't put words to ourselves, then we will never come into being. Back in the Middle Ages, there were these great handbooks that were made for priests who served in the confessionals. And many such manuals warn the confessors, when handling sins of luxuria, or sexual sins, to be both discreet and cautious. The fear was, on the one hand, that by asking directly, "Well, did you do this?" you'd be putting ideas into the person's mind. No, I didn't do that, but sounds like fun. On the other hand, and I think this was the much greater fear, was that if you put a name to a particular sin, what would in this case become known as sodomy, you're making it real. You're admitting that it's common enough to deserve a name. You're acknowledging that other people do it, and that once you have a name, there might develop a sense of kinship with others who commit the same sin. Those clergymen of the Middle Ages recognized something that we moderns often forget or ignore, and that's the power of words. Maybe we're scared of labeling, feeling that labels are confining. Maybe we think that by providing names and terms, we're limiting the imagination. But I want to argue the opposite, that names empower, that labels allow us to be. This was driven home to me more recently when I was working on my debut novel, Revolutionary. It tells the story of my ancestor, Deborah Sampson. There she is, and if you can see the family resemblance, you can shut up and keep it to yourself. To give you a brief synopsis, and I really could go on about Deborah all day, she was born in 1760. She was one of seven children. Her father abandoned the family when she was very young, and by age eight, Deborah's mother had sold her into indentured servitude. Aren't you glad your parents can't do that to you? She served a family in Middleborough, Massachusetts for about 10 years, at which point she was released from her indenture, and she became what was called a masterless woman, one of a very small group of women who supported themselves were independent. She supported herself by weaving cloth. In 1782, General George Washington put out the final call for recruits in the Revolutionary War, and towns had to pay a lot of money to get people to sign on. Deborah was really intrigued by the money, and she stole a set of men's clothes and signed on. She was, in her first attempt, unsuccessful, but in her second attempt, after running away from home, she was successful, and she served under the name of Robert Shirtliff for a year and a half in the Revolutionary War. Really, truly remarkable story. See my novel for full details. At the end of this war, she returned home and she resumed living as a woman. When I was researching the novel, I really wanted to find words from the time, from the 1780s, that might have been used to describe effeminate men, men who didn't measure up to the standards of masculinity. I thought I might be able to use the word Nancy, but no, it hadn't been invented yet, nor was gay or homosexual or even fag. The only words I could find were smock-faced. Anyone know what that means? No, neither did I, which made me want to use it all the more, which was the term for a young man who couldn't grow a beard, kind of like baby-faced today, and the term sodomite, the official legal term for a man accused of having sex with another man. Neither of those was what I was looking for. I wanted a word that described someone who didn't quite fit the gender categories, who was a bit too masculine to be a woman and a bit too feminine to be a man. In short, I was looking for myself, and I couldn't find any words. It isn't that people like me didn't exist. We did. It was just that society and language didn't recognize us. Imagine being a genderqueer person in the 1780s. Imagine being Deborah and wanting to live as a man, wanting to be free of all the restrictions imposed upon you. Yes, if you were strong and daring, you could do what she did. You could run away and disguise yourself. But it would be just that, a disguise. You had to cease being who you were and become someone else. And I think that's what labels and names do for us. They let us claim our own identity. The words we use are powerful. Words become, in a positive way, a vessel or a container for who we are. If you can't describe yourself, if you can't look back in history and find people like you, if there are no words for who you are or what you feel, then you are invisible. In the 80s, in rural Maine, there weren't any out people in my community. There weren't many out people on television. I barely understood what gay or lesbian meant. I rarely heard them used except as insults, and in my school, a girl was just as likely to be called a fag as a boy. It was just another insult. Throughout elementary school, I maintained a tomboy identity, and finally, in sixth grade, after years of begging, my mom let me cut my hair short. She almost immediately regretted this. Within a week of the haircut, we went out to eat in a restaurant, and I was kicked out of the women's room by a scandalized old lady. Moments like these confirmed that it wasn't just something inside my head. I really did look like a boy. I remember distinctly a day in school that year, a Friday, Music Appreciation Day. Katie Lang's album, Absolute Torch and Twang, had just come out. And the teacher played a song from it and then held the CD cover up for you young folks in the room. You won't remember this at all, but this was back when CDs had huge, huge packaging because record stores still sold records and CDs had to fit in the big record shelf, so there was massive packaging for this tiny little CD. He held up this big cover and he said, "Class, I think I found a girl who looks more like a boy than Alice does." First, I'd like to know in what universe that's appropriate. But secondly, I was delighted to see this cover. The whole class ran in for a closer look, and at last I ended up with a CD package in my hands. I was in complete awe. That was a woman? You could grow up and look like that? I remember thinking, can I do this? Can I be like her? And do I have to be a country singer to do it? My mother convinced me to grow my hair out before I went off to boarding school at Phillips Exeter. I did. And within my first few weeks at Exeter, I'd gravitated towards the GSA, mostly by virtue of finding the girls on campus who were jockey, not to mention the one teacher who was out as a lesbian and who was decidedly butch, and figuring out that they belonged to the GSA. By the middle of my freshman year, I'd come out to a lot of my friends as a lesbian. I was looking for a word that would explain what I felt, not like other girls. Lesbian seemed to work. It marked me as different. It let me do my butch tomboy thing. In the summer after my junior year, I was taking classes and living in Boston, where I joined a social and support group for GLBT youth. I went to a few events, and on perhaps my third meeting, the topic was transgender identity. I had never heard that word before. Four or five young folks made up a panel, and the rest of us sat in rather uncomfortable folding chairs and listened as they explained that being transgender meant being born as one sex but identifying with the other, or just not fitting socially expected gender categories. I thought. Then the meeting divided into gender groups, men, women, and transgender, so that we could all go off with our affiliations and discuss the topic more thoroughly. I went along with the women, took a seat, and listened as the group leader started off the conversation. Why don't we go around and discuss how each of us relates to or feels about our gender? I thought I knew what the other women would say. We were all lesbians, after all. I thought they'd say, "I never liked being a girl. I always wanted to be a boy." But instead, the first woman said, "I was a tough little kid, but when people called me a tomboy, I'd correct them and say, I was a tom girl." And the next one said that feeling feminine was important to her, and she was proud of being a woman. Another explained just how frustrating it was that sometimes people assumed that because she was a lesbian, she wasn't really a woman. It was my turn. I said, "I'm sorry, but I think I'm in the wrong room." And I stood up and went to join the transgender group. Over the next few weeks, I cut my hair short, and I asked people to call me Alex and to refer to me with masculine pronouns. At the end of the summer, I went home and came out to my parents. Then I went back to my boarding school for my senior year, following boys' dress code, coat and tie, and living as a guy. I recall moving into my girls' dorm that fall, carrying a box of books up the stairs, when someone's mother stopped me. "Oh, are you helping your sister move in?" she asked. "No," I said, "I live here." Her eyes widened. I didn't know the dorms were co-ed. She looked totally scandalized and scurried off to complain to the deans, I imagined. I was totally delighted. Not just at having annoyed someone, though I certainly derive a pleasure from that, but to have passed even in totally female terrain. And that was what my senior year was like. There were difficult discussions, a dorm parent who was certain I was just going through a phase, a Latin teacher who refused to call me Alex. But there was also my lacrosse coach, who, when the team picture was being snapped, said, "Okay, everyone, look beautiful, except Alex. You can look handsome." By the spring of my senior year at Exeter, I had started campaigning pretty hard. We had senior superlatives. I don't know if any of your schools have them, like most likely to be a politician, most likely to succeed, that kind of thing. I wanted most changed since freshman year. To be honest, I thought I was a complete shoo-in, but somehow I didn't get it. And I remember complaining to a friend of mine, and she said, "Just don't be a moron. You haven't changed at all." It took me a while to realize just how right she was. I hadn't changed at all. I had simply become myself. And that's part of what made the initial process of coming out so difficult. From the outside, it looked like I had changed. I was Alice one moment and Alex the next. People asked me about, and they still ask, about making the switch or when I decided to change. At 17 and endowed with all of the patience a 17-year-old can possess, which is to say none, I wanted it to be immediate. I wanted the people around me to accept me as and treat me as a guy. No pronoun slip-ups, no using the wrong name, no making stupid assumptions. I had to realize that though for me, this was simply one more step on the long road of becoming who I was, for those who didn't know me that well, it looked like a sudden change. I had been mulling this over, even though I hadn't realized it, for almost my entire life, all the way back to age 4, to the earliest memories I possess, when my brother would want to play Dukes of Hazzard and I would refuse to be Daisy. To me, it was inevitable. It was the interstate exit I'd been driving towards my whole life, and I'd finally gotten close enough to read the lettering and take the ramp. But explaining this to others and having them see it as gradual, incremental, meant to be, that was a harder matter. Prior to this summer, the last time I'd been in Paris, Maine, was the summer after my senior year in high school. I went back one last time. My parents were packing up to move overseas, and I wanted to legally change my name. I had just turned 18. My father was a lawyer, and he assured me that the paperwork and procedure were totally straightforward. I think he would have come along with me if I'd asked him, but as I say, I was 18. So I went alone. I put on an Oxford shirt and khakis and boat shoes, perhaps a little masculine, but to me, gender neutral. I sat in the courtroom and listened to the judge lecture a family whose case was before mine. The husband and wife had just married, and they were merging two sets of children. They wanted them all to have the same last name. This doesn't constitute adoption, the judge kept saying. And I sat there and listened to his admonitions about legality and responsibility and wondered about the link between names and identity, back to that question of what it means to be and how one does that, how one becomes and then just is. It seems like the simplest thing in the world, but it can be awfully difficult. When it was my turn to go before the judge, I explained that I wanted to change my name to Alex. He eyed me carefully. He asked whether I intended to impersonate a man. I said no. I had no intention to impersonate, I was going to be a man, but I didn't say that. He reminded me that impersonating a man was a crime in Maine. I explained that Alex was a gender-neutral name and that I wasn't changing my name to Alexander. He asked whether I wanted to change my sex and if I wanted to fill out the paperwork to do that legally. I replied that I had no intention to do so. I knew from my research that you needed a doctor's note to even begin such proceedings. I later found out that he was trying to trick me into admitting that I wanted to live as a man, which would have been a reason for him to deny the name change. But after much hemming and hawing, he signed the paperwork. Feeling a little defensive and embattled, I drove two towns over to the nearest DMV, got my picture taken, filled in the forms, and just as the elderly lady behind the counter was handing over the freshly laminated license, she paused. "Oh, my goodness," she said. "They've made a mistake. Let me fix that." A few minutes later, she returned and handed me a license that said Alex Myers and under sex, M. I slipped it into my wallet and walked out into the world, a newly made, though accidentally so, man. The interaction reinforced what I had known from my year at Exeter. If I met a person for the first time, they would take me to be a guy, with some few exceptions. It was much harder to deal with people who had known me before I came out. Of course, once I went off to college and into the rest of my life, I had to make the difficult decision of when and how and why to come out to people as transgender, to not just live as a guy. It's a decision I still make on a regular basis, coming out as something you do for your entire life. But at that moment, 18 years old and a freshly minted or freshly laminated man, I couldn't wait to escape from that hometown, from the context that I felt had confined me and defined me for too long. Gender is tough. How do you know what gender you are? And what is gender exactly? It's something I feel on the inside and express on the outside. It is therefore ultimately in the hands of other people, in their perception. I think that was part of what made it so important for me to go back to my hometown. By the time of my book talk, I was very comfortable in being who I was, transgender, a guy, but I was still missing one aspect of identity, not just being, but belonging. In a sense, identity is as much about place as it is about self. If there were still spots in the world where I couldn't be who I was, whether that was a family dinner or a school campus or a sports team, then I didn't fully exist. Paris, Maine had been a sort of blank spot for me, the place where I had come from, the place I feared returning to. At age 36, I could tell myself that Paris didn't mean much to me anymore. I'd long since moved away, but I'd spent as much of life living elsewhere as I'd spent living there. But it was a place that had known me only as a girl, and so I felt that I had to go back to show them what I had become and, in a sense, to show them what I had been when I lived there. I think that's why the note from Mrs. Burns meant so much to me. Her neat school teacher cursive telling me what she had seen, that I was true to myself. She was the teacher who taught me to read and write, who gave me my first lists of spelling and vocabulary, who picked books off the shelf in the library because she thought I would like them. I wonder if she saw, way back then, a glimmer of what I would become. Returning home can feel like moving backwards, a defensive posture. But I think identity is a process. To return home is not to go back to where one started, not if you have changed along the way. The Paris, Maine I returned to was not the same Paris, Maine I'd left 18 years before. I was not the same person either. Had I changed? Yes, certainly, an awful lot. And yet, no, not really at all. I had become myself, which is its own form of homecoming. Thank you. So I'm totally happy to answer any questions folks might have. Yeah?
What do you think the power of gender is, not only for transgender people, but for cisgender people as well?
Yeah, I actually think gender is power. I think it's how we explain and categorize and contain power in society. I think that we still live in a sort of patriarchal world, and that the male gender is the embodiment of what's normative, what's good, and what is powerful, and that when people want to assert that power, they act in a more manly way. So I actually think that gender is power.